Good evening. So today we are going to start with the analysis of an issue. So in my introductory class on the analytical writing, I have told you that there are two essays on the analytical writing. The first task is the issue, the second task is the argument. So we have already discussed the argument, so today we're going to start with the issue topic. So to write the issue topic, the computer gives you 30 minutes of time. You have approximately 150 topics online, which are called as the pool of issue topics. On the day you write the test, the computer randomly selects one topic and shows it to you, and you have to write your essay within that 30 minutes by typing it directly on the computer screen. Once you have written this essay, it goes to the ETS office, where it is evaluated and graded on a score between 0 and 6 points. It's done on a 0.5 scale, and therefore you can get anywhere from 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, right up to 6 points. Once you have completed the issue task, you get the analysis of an argument task. Now, one thing I want to tell you is every task comes with a timer. Each task you're given 30 minutes to do. Suppose you're completing your issue task in 25 minutes. You cannot take that extra 5 minutes and give it to your argument. The timer is 30 minutes. And the same way, suppose you write this essay and you want to take more time, by taking some time from the argument, you cannot do it. Every task is a timed one and you have to finish writing within the 30 minutes. One more thing I want to tell you very clearly is, if you do not complete your writing within time, and if you are still typing your essay and the 30th minute is on the computer screen, the computer will exit you from the topic. And you will be submitting an incomplete essay. Incomplete essays, when you submit, you're going to get a penalty for it. You might get a penalty of 1 point on what you are likely to score. So you don't want to lose what you have already got for yourself. Therefore, my advice to you is always have one eye on the time, because you cannot keep typing and forget about time. You need to have a little bit of concentration on the time so that you don't run out. That means planning and preparation beforehand becomes necessary. How much can I write? You know, you can't bite more than you can chew. That means you can't plan to write 1,000 words and you can type only 500 words in the time that you have. So you need to have an idea about how much you're capable of writing within the time given to us. So the thing is, when you say there is 30 minutes of time for every task, you don't get the 30 minutes to actually write your essay, because the 30 minutes also includes your reading the topic, analyzing the topic, planning your topic, and then writing your topic. So you see, in that 30 minutes, I would say that you need to have at least 5 to 7 minutes for the preparation stage. Reading, analyzing becomes very important. Once you have analyzed, then you plan what you're going to write. And then you start your writing. The reason why the test maker has already given you the topics online is for you to do the pre-preparation. Even before you go to write the GRE test, it is essential that you have at least one glance at all the topics that are likely to come and prepare on at least a few of them properly, so that on the day you write the test, you don't have any kind of problem in how much you can write and how far you can go about. So this prior preparation becomes necessary. I would also like to tell you, the very fact that these topics are there online, the expectations from you students become higher. You see, if I were to give you a topic now and ask you to write an essay, and you compose and write an essay, I would be like, okay, I gave the task now, and this student has done whatever he or she is capable of doing at this point of time. But suppose I give you a topic today, and I tell you prepare on it and write it tomorrow, what will my expectations from you will be? It will be higher. I will expect better from you, because I will think, I gave the student time. What did he or she do? Similarly, the test maker has published those topics for you already. And the very fact that he has published the topics means the expectations from you become that much more. So prior preparation becomes necessary for you. Don't ever wake up to the reality of your analytical writing one day before the test. I'm warning you. You need to do this in a phased manner. Start by doing a few topics every time, because many of these topics require a little bit of discussion and knowledge. Now, when you take these issue topics, the test maker says you don't need to have any kind of technical knowledge about these subjects. You don't need to be an engineer, you don't need to be a lawyer, you don't need to be a doctor, you don't need to be a teacher to be able to write about this, because these are general topics. All of you students with this many years of education behind you should have some degree of understanding of these topics. But there are going to be complex issues. There are going to be confusions about how to interpret those topics. That means discussing them beforehand with your teachers, with your mentors, with your fellow students, and gaining some kind of information makes sense. Because though the test maker says you don't need any technical knowledge or any kind of specific knowledge, let me be clear, you do need some degree of knowledge, general knowledge, in order to be able to write any kind of a convincing essay. What kind of examples I choose? How can I support my argument? You know, you need to have some degree of information about what's happening around you, what kind of, you know, experiences you've had. Use all these in your writing. So putting all those things beforehand and planning makes it easier for you to be well prepared and write confidently on the day of the essay, of the day test. Now, let us now look at the issue topic. Now, the first thing we have to do is we are told it's an analysis of an issue. Every topic that comes is going to make an issue for you. So first of all, what do we understand the word issue about? What does it mean? When do we say, I had an issue? When there is some kind of a conflict. An issue arises when there is a controversy, when there is an argument, when there is a difference of opinion. So all the topics that are here, the 100 and odd topics that are there here, are all issues, each expressing an opinion that is controversial. Your idea of what it is, or your opinion of what it is, or your viewpoint of what it is, may not necessarily be mine. Therefore, when there is this kind of a conflict, it becomes an issue. Now, these topics which are issues are taken from our everyday life. They could be taken from our academics. They can be taken from what's happening around us, right? So these are general issues. Now, each topic, when it comes, it gives you this issue. And if this paragraph is the topic, the issue, there is one more paragraph given below that, which is the direction. So when you get the topic on the computer screen, the first thing you do is you read the topic very carefully and you analyze it. Analyze here means you pinpoint the key words, interpret them, understand them. Try to get to know what this topic is trying to tell you. Once you have understood the topic, the second is you read the directions, because it's very crucial. The test maker keeps insisting on this. He says, write the essay on the basis of the instructions given. So every topic that you get don't have the same instruction. There are different type of prompts, different type of instructions. So we need to follow the instruction and write an essay by framing it according to what the test maker wants. So let's forget about the instructions first of all. Let's look at what the topics are supposed to be. Every topic will express an opinion or make a claim. Here, instead of evaluating that claim, whether it's logical or not, like you do in the argument, here what do? You are asked to express your opinion. You see, if the analysis of an argument is an objective writing, objective means your personal opinions don't come. You don't say, I agree with it or I disagree with it. There you say whether the argument's claim is sound or unsound, whether it's logical or illogical, where you are doing what is called as the job of a judge. and a judge remains impartial. He doesn't have his own personal opinion on the subject. He uses the yardstick to measure. Yardstick of what? Here we are using the yardstick of logic to measure whether the argument is sound. There, the argument topics is an objective analysis, an objective expression of your evaluation. Whereas in the analysis of an issue, it becomes subjective. Subjective in the sense you express your opinion. You put forward your viewpoint. So what does the test maker say? He says in every issue topic, you are asked to express your perspective. Express your perspective. What is your perspective? Your opinion, your viewpoint. And he says, in expressing your perspective, what does he want to do? He wants you to give suitable reasons to support your opinion. Then he says, wherever possible, give appropriate facts, evidences, examples to support your view. This is what the test maker is ultimately asking us to do. He says, you form your opinion. Express your opinion for the issue. See, this issue is controversial. There can be different opinions about it. He is asking you to take your stand. But taking a stand means you have to convince the other person about your opinion. So if I tell you something, you're not going to believe me. I have to give you appropriate reasons to support my view. That means, what is the task before us? In the analysis of an issue, the task is your intention is to persuade the reader who is reading your essay of your opinion. If you are saying something here, your intention is to convince the person as to why you have that particular opinion, what kind of reasons you are giving for your opinion, what kind of suitable examples or valid facts you can offer that will support your opinion. Therefore, you see, what you're ultimately doing in the analysis of an issue is you are constructing an argument. You are constructing an argument. What are the components of an argument? A claim and premises. So your opinion that you are expressing, your perspective becomes your claim, and all the reasons and facts and evidences you give are your premises that you're using in order to support the claim that you have made. So in the analysis of an argument, you're assessing an argument. In the analysis of an issue, you are presenting an argument yourself. Are we clear up to this point? Okay. Now, when the topic comes, remember, there is no such thing as this is the right opinion or the wrong opinion. The test maker has no any such kind of, let's say, right answer or wrong answer for you. Whatever stand you take, whatever, you know, decision you make about what opinion you want to express, what matters is how critically you're able to put forward your stand, how well you're able to use your logic in order to express your opinion and support it. So don't ever think if I express this opinion, the person who's reading it is going to may not, you know, agree with me, therefore he might, you know, not give me the scores I deserve. No. The person who's reading your essay is objective. For him, he's not having any opinion. What he's waiting for is for you to convince him of your opinion. So how persuasive I am, how clear I am in my stand, how well I'm able to express my opinion and support it with valid reasons becomes the crux of writing the analysis of the issue. Always remember, the intention behind writing here is that you have to convince the other person of your viewpoint. You are persuading the other person of your opinion. So, when the topic comes, as I said, read it, analyze it, understand it. Now, the next stage you have to ask is, do I agree with the topic? Do I disagree? If I agree, how far? Do I agree totally to a large extent or partially? If I disagree, how far do I disagree? Do I disagree with it totally? Do I disagree with it to a large extent? Or do I disagree only partially? This is something you have to discuss with yourself, because you have to ask, if I agree, what are the reasons I have for agreeing with the statement? Okay, now what are those reasons telling me? Do they convince the other person if these reasons are given, whether the agreement I'm coming up with is clear? Now, if I'm going to agree with the statement, will there be somebody who will disagree with me, and what will be his reason for disagreeing with my statement? Okay, if I'm agreeing with it, what kind of examples or reasons or illustrations I can give in order to support my opinion? What kind of examples and illustrations can be given for the opposing point of view? Because remember, many of the topics, the instruction will tell you to take both the side. If you are agreeing with it, it also says what would be the reason somebody would disagree with you. So therefore, it becomes very important that you are able to look at it from both the sides. 99% of the time, you will be writing essays where you are going to be discussing it from both sides. Because though you are expressing an opinion, you still remain a logical and impartial kind of expressor of that opinion. You're not like, this is my opinion, you better believe me. Even here, your intention is to be logical in convincing the other person, where you admit that there are possibilities the other person might disagree with my stand. Now, let's take a topic. Now, when we take topics, the topics can be many and varied. The first thing is, you have to read the topic. Now, what stand do I take? A topic says, let me make this here, one of your topics from your issue: all facts are stubborn. No matter what your wishes or aspirations are, you cannot alter facts. This is a topic. What does this topic do? It makes a generalization. It gives you an opinion. What does it say? All facts are stubborn. Now, the most important thing here is, look at the keywords. Look at the keywords. The first statement is what the topic wants you to take a stand on, where it says facts are stubborn, not facts. All facts are stubborn. So let's discuss the word stubborn. In what way does the word stubborn fit into this context? Stubborn as what? Constant. Stubborn as constant. Stubborn as unalterable. Stubborn as rigid. Stubborn as unchanging. So what this argument says essentially is, facts cannot be changed. Even you have wishes, or whether you have ambitions or aspirations to change facts, they cannot be altered, is the expressed opinion. Now, before I'm going to come to any kind of a decision about what stand I take, we need to look at the keywords, the facts and the word stubborn. Let's ask ourselves, what are facts? What can be considered to be facts? What can be taken to be facts? Give me a fact. The sun rises in the east. Does it? The earth is rotating around. That's why it looks like it's rising in the east. But it's a fact. It doesn't rise in the west. Accepted. So, sunrise in the east, she says, is a fact. Come on, some of the facts. Some of the facts I can get from you. Yes? Time and tide waits for no man. Time. Time is something that cannot be stopped. You cannot go to the past. You can't go to the future. Nor can you hold on to time. Today you're very happy. You can't make this day last forever. Fact. Yes? So time cannot stop for anyone. True. Fact. Fact. Yes? The moon revolves around the earth. The moon is a satellite of the earth. Let me ask you some facts. Who is the Prime Minister of India? Who is the Prime Minister of India? Manmohan Singh. Who is the President of the United States? Barack Obama. What day is it today? What day? It's a Tuesday. It's a Tuesday. Which year is this? 2014. Which month? February. Facts, all of them. Right? Okay. Let me ask you some more facts. Where were you born? Where were you born? In the hospital, he says. I'm talking about the location, the place. Where were you born? You tell me. In Hyderabad. You were born in Hyderabad. So do you consider yourself to be an Indian? Yes, you are an Indian, a native born Indian, right? Okay, let's ask some of the questions. Did the World Trade Center episode happen? Was it destroyed? When did it happen? 2001, September 11th. Do you want to go and change that event? Yes. Can you? Do you want to be born in New York? Yes. Yes. But can you change it? No. No, you can't. What's the date today? 4th of February. What will be the date tomorrow? So does this 4th February stay forever? No. Dr. Manmohan Singh is the Prime Minister of India. We are going for an election in the month of May. 100% certain that this gentleman is not going to remain the Prime Minister of India after that. Yes or no?
Yes.
The American system of politics is, presidential election is, any president has only 2 tenures. So once President Obama finishes his second tenure, he's not going to be the president. All these are facts, but they will change. Today it's a fact you're preparing for your GRE test. You want to get yourself a good score. Are you working for it? Yes. Are you striving for it? Yes. You're preparing for it? Yes. You get yourself a good score because of your hard work. You get yourself an admission into a good college. And all your aspirations to go and study in the US in a good college will become a reality with your hard work. It's not a fact today, but all your hard work will convert it into a fact tomorrow. Right? You are a native-born Indian, a fact. Tomorrow you get yourself a green card, an American citizenship, you still cannot change the fact that you are an Indian. You got the point I'm making? Facts, some of them are stubborn, but some of them can be changed. You don't want this incident to have happened in the past, but it has happened. You can't do anything about it. But you can make changes in your life and change facts which are now true into something which is different tomorrow. It's all in our hands in that sense. Long time back, it was believed that the earth is the center of the universe. The sun, moon, stars and everything was revolving around us. The church led us to believe that. The church said we are living in a geocentric universe. When Galileo came up with the concept of saying that the sun is in the center and everything revolves around the sun, the church was very angry. Till it was proved, because the telescope was invented, that definitely it is the sun, which is in the center. Then what was a fact till then for centuries had to be completely changed. So when science gives us new information, what are considered to be facts today may not be a fact. Today it's a fact a disease like AIDS has no cure. Are we working for a cure? Yes. Billions of dollars are being funded for research to find a cure. If not today, if not tomorrow, we are likely to get a cure. Right? So what may not be a fact today may become a fact in the future. We haven't been able to see a single, alien from space today. Possibilities, 100 years from now, we might be actually able to communicate and travel across the space and be part of the alien culture as well. So what is not a fact today might become a fact tomorrow. You got the point. So this statement that says all facts are stubborn cannot be accepted totally. But can it also be disagreed with totally? Because we have seen there are some facts that cannot be changed. We are all human beings. We are all mortal. We want to live forever. Can we? Even the richest of human beings with billions of dollars, they can't preserve themselves and keep them immortal and alive. Aging is a process that nobody can change. You can go for cosmetic surgery. You can do all kinds of, things to make yourself look young. But at some point of time, you are going to age, isn't it? So these are facts that are stubborn. They have not been altered. They may not alter at all. But there are innumerable factors which we think to be fact today have changed over a period of time. So in this particular argument, in this particular, issue, we need to take a stand, and the stand I take here would be, I agree partially. I agree partially because in this particular situation, in this particular, scenario, if there are facts that are stubborn, there are enough facts which are not stubborn. So therefore, if you agree with it partially, it means I take a stand where I am doing this 50-50. Now, how do I construct an essay here? How do I go about putting forward my view? I'm going to give you a very simple technique. You are going to divide your essay into three basic components. The three basic components would be, how do I start my essay? I always do it with an introduction, right? The introduction, you have to keep it as simple as possible because you don't have the time. So you can't start thinking, what am I going to write? You have to start writing as quickly as possible. So for the ball to get rolling, for you to start writing, the best place for you to start is to take the topic and start rewriting it in your own words. The moment you start writing the topic in your own words, the ideas will start flowing. So my advice to you would be to paraphrase the topic, and in the process of paraphrasing the topic, express your opinion in the introduction. Okay, so how do I do it? If I say facts are so many things. Facts which are there today, facts which are there tomorrow, facts which may not be there forever. There are some facts which are there forever, some facts which may not be there forever. So statement which states that all facts are stubborn, that means unchanging and unaltered, cannot be taken to be a true statement, cannot be taken to be a logically valid statement. One cannot assume all facts are unchanging. Therefore, the expressed opinion I can make here is that if there are facts which are stubborn, there are equal number of facts that are changeable. Now that I have given my expressed opinion in the introduction, the body of the essay that I'm going to write, I'm going to divide it into two basic parts. The first part, let us say, if I'm going to start off by saying, I agree. What are my reasons for agreement? So I take up those reasons, one or two. So here I talk about, you see how important your examples and illustrations are going to become. You cannot write this essay without your example. So you start off by giving examples of facts that cannot be changed. Examples of those facts that have remained immutable, unchangeable from the past and will remain so forever. Put forward those kind of examples first and express your opinion there. Up to this extent, one can accept the view. But in the second part of the essay, if this is I agree, then what are my reasons to disagree? Having discussed all the facts in the previous paragraph, which clearly indicate that facts are stubborn and cannot be changed, a further look into facts will make us realize that there are many facts that can be changed. One, time can change facts. New information can alter the current facts because the new information can throw new light on the present facts. Or time itself can change because we are aspiring or working for it. For example, the facts that can change are those which are temporary. Those which are true today and may not be true tomorrow can be temporary facts and can be altered. Whether it's the day we are living in or the year we are living in, or whether we talk about world leaders who are holding certain positions which are temporary, all these facts which are true for the time being will not be true forever. Facts that have been considered to be facts have changed because science has thrown new information. Whether it's about the earth being the center of the universe or whether it is about the number of planets we have in our own galaxy. The invention of new technology has thrown up so much of information that has overset the facts that were taken to be true in the past and has introduced new scientific facts now. Finally, facts can alter if we aspire for them. Today, we are desperate to find a cure for a disease like AIDS. We are working for it. And there's every possibility that we will find a cure. At one point of time, there was no cure for a disease like cancer. Today, we can successfully defeat this disease if it is detected early. So, we have found vaccinations for a disease like chickenpox and smallpox. At one time, smallpox was wiping the world population. With the invention of the vaccination for smallpox, we have been able to successfully prevent this disease from being so destructive. So, with man's aspirations and his striving, many facts that are true today may not remain facts tomorrow. Examples again. Now, conclusion. Summarize. Therefore, as one can see, the statement that facts are stubborn is true to some extent, because there are innumerable facts that are unalterable. Up to that extent, one can accept it to be true. But a further discussion also makes us realize there are innumerable facts that remain altered because of various factors. Therefore, the best I can do here is say that some facts are stubborn, whereas some facts are alterable and changeable. That is my final opinion of the topic. To write this, I had to be very systematic. I had to have a clear-cut structure. If you are confused, if you start writing, these are the reasons for agreeing, and then immediately next line you write, this is the reason for disagreeing, your thoughts will not be clearly represented. This is analytical writing. Analysis means you have to be clear. So therefore, I'm going to ask you to structure your essay and bifurcate your ideas. Put them in separate compartments. If you're discussing about the reasons you disagree, discuss about them completely. If you're discussing ideas for agreement, then discuss them properly. Don't get yourself jumping from one side to the other as and when you want. State your facts. See, I have three reasons for agreeing. You can divide this first part of your essay into three minor paragraphs. Then these are my reasons for disagreeing. I have about two, three different things I want to say, I can put them into small three minor paragraphs. So keep dividing your essay into paragraphs. Don't write it like one long, you know, elongated passage. An essay is never a long passage. An essay will always have a structure. Anyone who speaks will tell you what he's going to speak about, then he will speak about it, then he will summarize it. A good speaker will do that. Remember, the same works for writing as well. When you introduce, be clear what you are going to write. Tell the person who's reading what to expect. In the body, fulfill your promise that you made in the introduction. Express your thoughts, give the valid reasons. Finally, don't end your essay without a proper conclusion. Don't just leave it hanging. You know, when you read a story, let's say a novel, the last four pages of the novel, when you read the whole book, you realize the last four pages are missing. How will you feel? You'll feel cheated. Right? How dare it? Similarly, the person who's reading your essay, when you don't leave it with a conclusion, he'll feel cheated. He'll be like, what's happening? There should be a proper end to what this person has written. So that conclusion gives you a completion. So always make it a point of concluding by summarizing what you've written and express your final opinion in the last concluding paragraph. Many times when you run out of time, the conclusion becomes sacrificed. Right? That's the reason why program your timing. Make your timing work for you. Now, as I said, 20 to 22 minutes is the maximum time you can expect for actually writing of the essay. So many of you ask me, how much am I supposed to write? The test maker knows very clearly the constraints. He knows he's not given you a lot of time. And he knows, therefore, you can't write pages and pages here. But he also expects you to do your job properly. That means you must be able to write what is reasonably required for you to express your thoughts. That means there should be this format for it. And I would say, if your typing speed is good and you have prepared yourself well, around 500 words should not be a problem. About 500 words, because when you write examples, your words just flow. When you give examples, your thoughts will come in, right? So therefore, the more topical and proper examples you get, the more convincing your essays become. Many times, an example will express your thoughts much more clearly than 100 statements you make about trying to convince. So good examples become very, very important in writing. So the question to be asked is, what kind of examples am I supposed to give? I'm an Indian writing. So if I give examples, how is this person sitting there in the US supposed to understand what I'm writing? Now when I say, when you give examples, you don't simply say, for example, so and so, and leave it at that. Every example has to be illustrated, explained. Always keep one thing in mind, that the person who's reading your essay is not going to understand everything you're going to write unless you make it understandable. So if you're writing an example of a great entrepreneur, don't expect an American to know somebody called Dhirubhai Ambani in India. You got the point I'm making? So introduce the character, tell what he is, and then use him, if you want to use him, as to why he is standing as an example of a great entrepreneur. Explain. Also remember, you can't always write examples taken from an American background. You can't. You have to use your own experiences, your own knowledge bank. Use it, but use it effectively. Use it effectively. In such a way that the person who reads is able to appreciate what is your reason for giving this illustration. And believe me, if you give good examples, your essay will not only be effective, it will be more interesting. And when it is interesting, the person who reads will get caught up with what you write. That means there's every possibility that you'll be more strong in convincing the other person of your view. But the example must be appropriate and valid. If you take an example, it should work. Not any example or every example. If I'm choosing this example, is it working for me? Why am I giving this example? Does that make sense? So think of all these things when you're writing. When you're writing your essays. Now that I've given you a broad picture about this particular topic, there are going to be topics where you can take a stand, where you can support something to a large extent. You see, if this is a topic where I've taken a stand of 50:50, there are going to be many topics where I take a stand of 80:20. 80% I agree or disagree, 20% I agree or disagree. Here, how do I structure my essay? How do I plan? If the introduction is going to be similar to this, where you paraphrase the topic, explain your topic for what you think it is, introduce your opinion and discuss your opinion in the introduction, then the body of the essay, instead of dividing it into two broad components, because here you have equal reasons for agreeing and equal reasons for disagreeing, in the writing of this type of essay, the body must be more focused on your opinion. So you can take up 1, 2, 3, however many paragraphs you have for supporting this view. I agree with it to a large extent. If that is what you say, then you can use all these paragraphs initially for expressing of your reasons and supporting them with suitable examples and illustration. One of the topics is competition is more harmful than it is good. I'm paraphrasing and giving it to you. One of the topics is competition is more harmful than it is good. What is your opinion? Now, competition, he says, is more harmful than it is good. Let us say I take a stand thinking that it is, in fact, more good than harmful. So if I think that competition is good, then what are my reasons for saying competition can be good? What does competition do? Competition can increase your interest. When there's competition, there's always more involvement and more interest. Competition can raise your performance. Competition can bring out the best in others, in ourselves. Competition can give us the best access to the best things in the market. So many things. Whether you have competition in your academic pursuit, whether you have competition in your jobs, employment, whether you have competition in politics, whether there is competition in business and products that are sold, it's all for the good. When you have competition when you're studying, in a class of, let's say, 30 students, you're competing to get yourself a scholarship, then what will you do? You'll push yourself to perform at your best levels. That means that that level of performance will go higher. If you're capable of doing this, you'll in fact push yourself to do something more. In a workplace, if there is competition, then this competition can also give the company the best from its employees, and the involvement of the employees will increase, and competition among the workers will also lead to more promotions and incentives for everyone. If there is competition in the field of business, in products which are available, today if there are, you know, many products in the market and there's competition, that means as buyers, we get the best. If there is only one car in the market and you have no choice, then that product can be sold at whatever cost and whatever way. But when 10 cars come into the market, then each one will be trying to outdo the other and give you the best price and the best product. That means as a consumer, you get the best. In politics, when there's competition, that means the people have a choice in a democracy to vote for the person or the party that they think deserves to be the elected leaders. So if there is competition in sport, it leads to higher achievements. It leads to great achievements in life, whether it's in Olympics or whether it is in sporting activities, athletes, athletics, swimming, gymnastics, cricket. Competition gives so much of zest and improvement to our performances. Now, I would discuss all these things that leads to my thinking that competition can be very good. But then you see, there are reasons that somebody is going to refute my argument. Somebody is going to say competition can be harmful. Now, here, therefore, having said all the reasons why I agree with the topic, the last part of the essay, maybe one para, I'm going to discuss all the points that can refute my argument. But there are going to be many persons who are going to detract my argument, stating that competition has been harmful as well. For example, competition has led to great corruption and and healthy practices. Whether it is in sport or academics or in politics, competition led to lot of unhealthy, unethical behavior. Whether it is match fixing or taking enhanced drugs in sports, whether it is politicians being corrupt and paying large sums of money for winning the elections, or whether it is businesses who are trying to outdo their rivals by killing their rivals' product through unhealthy advertisements, competition has brought out the negative aspect of the life. But here I will give my opinion. I will say, but by itself, competition is not the culprit. I would say how we deal with competition, our human attitude towards competition is what makes it harmful. Therefore, competition by itself is not harmful. When we take competition to unhealthy limits, then competition itself becomes bad. Therefore, competition in the right spirit will always bring the best. Therefore, I stick to my opinion that I agree that competition can be, I disagree that competition is harmful. It can be more good than bad. Here, what did I do? I took the major part of the essay in discussing all the points which say why I disagree with the statement that competition is harmful. But before I end, I'm also discussing what could be a reason why somebody is going to dispute my statements. And I'm going to bring that here and then end up with my final conclusion. This is where I agree to it to a large extent or disagree with it to a large extent. My essay will be 3/4 of it, the body will be in projecting my own opinion, 1/4 of it in projecting somebody's, disputing my opinion, and finally the summary, the conclusion will be summarization and my final concluding statement. Is that clear? So, how you again formulate your thoughts and structure your writing becomes very important. So, this is not unstructured writing. This is a very structured kind of writing. Now, having said all these things, let me put very quickly some few points before you about the writing of the issue. The first thing about writing of the issue that I want to put forward here is that when you get a topic, be very clear that you are writing on the topic and the topic only. The first point, very basic, write on the topic. Now, you think, why is she telling us this? When I get a topic, will I not be writing about it? Yes? If I tell you to write about something, you are not going to be writing. If I'm telling you to write about, discuss about competition, you're not going to be writing about something else. That's what you're thinking. But you see, one thing I want to tell you. Every topic is expressing an opinion. Every topic has an attitude. You are expressing your attitude. If you deviate from that, you're going to go wrong. I'm going to prove my point, what I'm trying to say. I'm going to give you here a statement with an attitude. Let's say I gave you this statement with an attitude. I'm giving my opinion that the dog is the most useful animal in the world. Let me further put it this way. Of all the animals in the world, the dog is the most useful. Let's put it this way. Now, I want you to write a persuasive essay. I want you to take a stand and tell me what would be your reasons. Let's say we take a stand that we support the statement. What would be your reasons for supporting it? You tell me. Why would you want to support the statement? Of all the animals in the world, the dog is the most useful, is the statement. Now we need to write an essay in support of it. So what are we going to write? What are you going to tell me? Yes? that you're going to tell me about what the dog does, right? How it is useful. So you're going to tell me that the dog guards the house. Okay. Two. Yes. A dog is obedient. It is an obedient animal. Okay. Can be used as police dogs. Okay. Man's best friend. Mm-hmm. What else? That's all? You're done with it? You know, if you're going to write all these things, I'm going to give you. Let me ask you a simple question. Do I have any doubts about the dog being useful? Is that what I said? Prove to me that the dog is a useful animal. Did I ask you to do that? What did I ask you to do? I expressed an opinion. I said no other animal is as useful as a dog. Right? Of all the animals in the world, the dog is the most useful. You just told me about the use of dog. You didn't write about the topic. I said write on the topic. What is that you're supposed to do? You are supposed to compare the dog with other animals and prove the dog is more useful. Simply telling me about the use of dogs is not going to prove anything at all. What does it prove ultimately? That the dog is useful. But does it prove that the dog is more useful than all other animals? So, what are you supposed to do here? Yes, you cannot simply write about the use of dogs. You have to every point of time, if you say that the dog is the man's best friend, you have to say why. There are many, many animals that are kept as pets by man. A cat, a horse, a donkey, why even a snake are man's pets. But have you ever heard of any other pet which is as faithful and as closely connected with a human being as a dog has been? Examples of dogs being man's best friend. Take examples, concoct examples if we don't have any. Stories are with so many episodes of dogs standing by man and protecting him, his master. Isn't it? Has any other animal done such a thing? So dog can do that. It's loyal, it's faithful, it has certain tendencies that make it most useful as a partner for man, as man's companion. Literally, a man who's living all alone can live happily if he has a dog with him. Can he say that with any other animal? No. Secondly, when you say the dog guards the house, if you tie a tiger in front of your house also, it will guard your house. But the problem is, the tiger cannot differentiate between an enemy and a friend. The dog is both gentle and ferocious. It can attack the intruder. It can welcome the friend. It has the intelligence to do it. No other animal has that. The dog can be used as a seeing eye dog. Of all animals in the world, the next animal which has the highest IQ after the human being is the chimpanzee. But can you train a chimpanzee to take care of a blind man? No. One moment it will take it, next moment it will be a monkey. So the dog can. You have seen dogs taking blind people, crossing roads, guiding them, guarding them, and doing all these things. Dogs can differentiate the smells. It can follow the track of a criminal. It can smell and remove the smell of bombs. In airports, dogs can differentiate the smell of drugs from other smells. Therefore, criminals who are carrying drugs can be easily found. Can other animals do it? There are animals which have good sense of smell. But you can't train them to do these things. Therefore, though a horse can be extremely useful, it has been man's, animal of burden. It has carried carriages, it has taken us all over. But let us talk about donkeys or camels or cows, which are all useful in different ways. But when you compare the variety of uses along with the fact that it has an emotional bond, the dog supersedes every other animal. So you see, when I said write on the topic, remember you're expressing an opinion and you're trying to persuade the other person. You're not giving information. You're not giving information. Information is not what is being sought here. Facts and figures are not being asked here. You must always remember, why am I using those facts and figures? Why? Because I'm expressing a certain opinion. So always remember, you're writing a persuasive essay. So don't fill your essay with facts and information. Make your essay work by trying to convince the other person with those facts and figures. That means these facts can be molded, changed in such a way that you can persuade the other person that the dog is superior and more useful than any other animal. Facts by itself is not what is being asked. How you make those facts work for you, that is what matters here. So the most important thing, as I said, is you write on the topic. The second thing that I have already told you, the organization. How did I ask you to organize your essay? Into 3-point approach: the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. I said, change the format of your writing based on what you are, how you are agreeing. If you are agreeing to a large extent, make your writing work for you. Organize your writing, as I said, by structuring it as I put it on the board just now. If you are agreeing with it to a partial extent, where you're going to divide your essay into two basic components, what are the reasons for agreeing and what are the reasons for disagreeing? Organize your thoughts. Structure your writing. Don't write like a long paragraph. So, examples are very, very important, but as I said, make your examples relevant to the reasons you present. Therefore, be very careful that your examples work for you. Examples can carry a lot of weight. Always remember, stay out of controversial examples. Don't write any political examples. Stay out of your students. Remain apolitical. There was the student who came to me some time back. It was, I think, more than four years back. He said, ma'am, I got just a 3 out of 6 on my writing. I don't know, maybe because I wrote about Saddam Hussein, I got less. I said, if you have such doubts, then why did you write? Why? Why should we? You're students. So remain neutral. Don't express any political opinion that is going to get you. See, the test maker says, whatever you say, they're not going to take anything personal about it. But why take a chance? Stay out of anything that is controversial. You got the point I'm making here? Remain non-controversial in your controversy. That's what I would say. Okay, so make your examples work. It doesn't have to be only American, but it has to be explained in such a way that the person is able to understand what your example is trying to prove. Now, so far, when I've been talking about writing of essays, I haven't brought the language element into it. Because ultimately, the writing on the GRE is not about your language, your beautiful vocabulary. The reason why you're being evaluated here is for the critical response you're giving to the topic, your logical response. But I want to tell you that when you're writing, your language elements will definitely play a role in how many score points you're going to get. If you've got these fantastic ideas, but you're not able to express them properly, you are still going to have a problem in expressing your thoughts. So the language elements that I'm going to bring into place here is, one is, I'm going to talk about vocabulary. I'm going to talk about your vocabulary. The fifth, I'll come back to the vocabulary. Okay, the fifth I'm going to talk about is your grammatical proficiency. These are the other two things that I'm going to talk about. Now, when I said that your vocabulary is going to play a role, let me caution you. you know, many of you have this, you know, thing that when you're doing your verbal reasoning section, you learn all these wonderful words there. So you think, this is the best place for me to start experimenting with all those wonderful words. Let me use all those high-sounding words and use them as much as possible to impress someone. No. When I said vocabulary, I don't mean all those high-sounding words. I mean contextually appropriate or suitable words. The right word in the right context that you express is what I'm talking about. You don't have to become pretentious here. You know, the moment you start using those high-sounding words without knowing their meanings properly, you definitely are going to sound very weird. There was this student who was talking about advertisements, and he started writing, instead of advertisements, propaganda. He thought propaganda looked much higher and better. But there is a distinctly a little bit of a negative tinge to the word propaganda. It's over-publicizing something. So you see, he was not able to express himself properly because he used a wrong word in the wrong place. So the thing is, be yourself. Use words with which you are most confident and comfortable. But at the same time, try to make your writing as articulate. That means using words that are effectively needed. Plays a very important role in expressing your thoughts, but at the same time, I'm going to ask you to not experiment and use words with which you are unfamiliar. Remain natural. Because if you use those difficult words without knowing them, believe me, a person who's reading your essay will know that you're being pretentious. Okay, so let's remain natural in our writing. The grammatical proficiency I'm talking about has nothing really to do with grammar per se. I'm not talking about noun or pronoun or verbs or adjectives. Grammatical proficiency, when I say, I'm talking about your sentence structure. How we structure and construct our sentence, how we deliver our thoughts clearly, lucidly, clearly matters. Now, why I brought the grammatical proficiency here, because is grammar teaches us that sentences are constructed in a certain pattern. Every language has grammar, the building blocks. Every language has noun, pronoun, verb, adjective, adverbs, and so on. But every language has its own convention, its rules about how you construct the sentence, what makes a sentence grammatically correct. How you put those words, in which order you put the word, matters a lot. The problem with people like us is we are what is called as non-native born speakers of English. So one of the major errors in our writing, in our speaking of English, is we follow the translation method. We think in our mother tongue, and verbatim we try to translate what we are thinking into English, and therefore what we are trying to say comes out looking very stilted, artificial. And many times what we are trying to say may not even be communicable to a person who has no knowledge of our own Indian language. So let me start by giving you a simple sentence. In English, the structure of a sentence will always be the subject, which is your noun or your pronoun, plus the verb, which is your action word, plus the object or the complement. So if I say Rama plays cricket, you have Rama the subject, the verb plays, and cricket is the object of his playing. I would like somebody here to tell me the same sentence in Hindi. Tell me the sentence in Hindi. Rama cricket khelta hai. So what's the structure? Rama cricket khelta hai. Subject, object, verb. This is a structure of our own language. Subject, object, verb. Do you ever say in English, Rama cricket plays? Will you say in Hindi, Rama khelta hai cricket? You understand what I'm saying here? The structure in which we put the words, in every language is decided by its own conventions. So when we follow the translation method from our language to another language, the language that which we are translating verbatim is not going to come naturally. Many times I have seen this happening in my evaluation of your writing skills, because I've seen many times the sentence you have constructed is very, 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 I would say, un-English, non-English. Though all the words are in English, it is not English. So I'm going to give you one sentence here. And I'm going to, in fact, give you two sentences. And you're going to tell me which sentence is English and which is not. Okay. Second one is English. There are many languages in my country. In my country, many languages are there. So, translate the sentence and tell me in Hindi. Hamare desh mein bahut sare bhashaein hain. Right? So, I have translated it literally. Now, try to translate this sentence into Hindi. There are. If you say in Telugu, what will you say? Unnai. First. There are. Hai. What? Bahut sare bhashaein hamare desh mein. Does that sound right to you? So you see, every language has its own rules. Construction of the sentence conventions, you have to absorb them. Exposure to the language is a must. The more you're exposed to the right language, the more you start thinking in English rather than thinking in your mother tongue and translating it into English. You know, in Amitabh Bachchan, in one of his movies, says, I you know, talk English, I walk English, I do whatever in English. So you see, you need to do that. Your thought process should be in this language in order to be able to write effectively. The more you expose yourself to this language, the more you become proficient in it. Your reading plays a major role. Second, watching good programs on TV. Whether it's news broadcast or whether it's good programs, they all impinge on our consciousness. Subconsciously, we have to evolve. We have to train. The moment you start thinking, is it right or wrong, it won't work. Language has to come like an instinct. It should come on its own. So I'm going to have to tell you that you need to learn to write English, not a translation of your mother tongue in English. Then only your language will come out naturally. You have to aspire and work for that. Is that clear? Okay. Now, one more thing I want to bring you here is your punctuations, especially when you're writing, do make a lot of impact. Your capital letters, your full stops, you know, your commas, your hyphens, they all have an impact on our writing. They lend what is called as clarity to our writing. So, I've had sometimes students writing one whole paragraph without a single full stop. I become breathless reading it because they keep joining the sentences with ands and because and wherefores, and the sentence goes on and you don't know where it begins and where it ends. Learn to put a stop. Learn to practice writing sentences which are short and carrying on, because the sentences which are short and to the point will always be more grammatically correct than sentences which are very complicated, and then you lose your tenses, you lose your verbs, you lose everything in the process. So structure your sentences short and to the point by using punctuation marks. You know, there is a very amusing incident, an anecdote that was narrated to me by one of my professors when I was doing my MPhil. You know, he was talking to us about the importance of punctuation, and he told us about the fact that a single punctuation saved a person's life. The story is about Russia. The Tsar of Russia, the King of Russia, realized that his wife, the Tsarina, was having an affair with one of his courtiers. This man's name was Rasputin. Bonia made a very famous song of Rasputin. So, this courtier who had this affair with the queen, obviously the king didn't want him anymore. So he sent a command, a written command to his soldiers. And this is what he wrote. Now I'm writing verbatim what he wrote in Russian in English. So it won't look like a proper English sentence. He wrote this. This is the king's instruction. Hang him, not let him go. This was a Russian sentence. This is what he wrote exactly. Now the queen got to know about the king's order. And somehow she got hold of the command. And she made a small change. What she did was this. This is what she did. Now what happens here? Here it becomes hang him, not let him go. And this fellow escaped. So you see, a single comma, its position changed the whole command. So punctuations are not to be underestimated. They are important. You need to use them when you're putting forward examples, when you are structuring your sentences, put those full stops and commas and capital letters. They will bring clarity to your writing. So, the facts here. To write on the topic, you're writing a persuasive essay. You're not simply writing to tell the person some information. You're using the information in order to convince a person of a particular view. Organize your essay. Stay focused on the construction, the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. Make your examples relevant to the reasons you present. Examples play a key role in raising the points. So think up of good examples. Think up of good reasons for supporting your view. Vocabulary. Appropriate word in the appropriate context. That's what I mean when I talk about vocabulary. Grammatical proficiency. Structuring your sentence according to the conventions of English. Not translating it from your mother tongue and trying to write English as it is supposed to be in your own language. Finally, use punctuations for making your language effective in its communication. Because you see, in writing from my school, I've been taught there are three cornerstones for writing, the three basics, fundamentals. Writing, A, B, and C of writing, we are told right from our childhood. What is this three fundamental basics of writing, the three ABCs? A, accuracy. B, brevity. C, clarity. These are the three cornerstones on which you have to write. What you write has to be accurate. Nobody has time anymore to read if you write on and on. Everything is now time, right? Whether you write an email, whether you write an SMS, whether you write any kind of a report, it has to be to the point. That means you have to be accurate and precise in what you are conveying. The second, brevity. Brevity, as I said, is to the point, being clear. Accuracy also means that you use the right word in the right place, right? Therefore, the construction of your sentence and the right word in the right place is accuracy. And being to the point is brevity. And clarity, as I said, comes from your punctuations and the construction of your sentences. So all these three, if you are able to combine them effectively, your writing becomes better. It's good that we aspire to be good writers because writing is a very important skill. Not only in your academic future, but tomorrow when you go to any kind of a job, your writing is going to play a key role. So improving on that becomes very, very essential. So now is the time on the GRE you're playing a role in getting a good score here. So why not start now? Why not start now? That's what I want to tell you. So today, let's take a break now, because tomorrow we are going to do something very important. We are going to take the topics. We are going to read the topic. We are going to read the direction. We are going to discuss the topic among ourselves. We are going to get ideas, and we are going to see how we can construct and develop and write those essays. So we're going to see the different directions and instructions we have, and we're going to structure it. Are you with me so far?